grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail, the fear surrounds me. You never fail. The wars are now.
Here, that it great God promise that has changed our spirits, that not only will we fall in love with you and return back to that first love experience, dear God, you will open up our eyes, Lord, to the people that are surrounding us right now, the strangers within my gate, and see your children, the children that you died for. Let us not walk past by without a prayer, without a conversation. Open up the ways and avenues, dear Lord, because we are living in the last days, dear Lord. We don't want to play church, Father God. We want Christ to reign in our hearts. We want your love to reign, the word to come from our lips, be coming from the Holy Spirit. So Lord, touch this congregation now. Touch me, Father, because truly, Lord, I surrender to you now. I surrender every part of being of me. The words that are being spoken is not from Richard Carroll, but from the Holy Spirit. Only your words that need to be spoken, Father. Those are the only words that need to be heard, because there is power, and there's greatness, and there's love, and there's transformation. We ask you.
I do.
Have to test it. Great. Okay. Who was here last week? Not too many of you, right? We have a lot of visitors. But if you notice in the beginning, we have here Jesus the Christ, revelation of God's love. We broke it down. Last week was the introduction. We broke down what Jesus represented. If I look at my old notes, if I have them here, I don't know if I do. Did I lose them? Let me take a look first. There was something there that was very interesting. You know me, I don't have perfect memory. Ask my wife. The rich age is not there. Okay. And it gives a quick reference. That's all I'm going to do. And this is about Jesus, what the word Jesus means. And the word Jesus means in the Greek is the name Joshua. And Joshua, I think we have a Joshua in the family here, do we? All right, run back here. So Joshua, guess what your name means? Literally, God is salvation. So the angel's message to Joseph was, you shall call his name, for God is salvation. And Christ means the anointed, and the Greek Hebrew translated to Messiah. And to be anointed means to be consecrated, and to be consecrated means to be devoted. And Jesus was the anointed one, the consecrated one. He was not Jesus of Nazareth, he was Jesus Christ. And what was his purpose here? His purpose was is that this is a love story between God and man. God used his son to reveal his love. In our scripture reading earlier, we said that he sent his prophets. He sent his prophets, and they stoned him. God says, you know what? I'm going to send my son. Surely he'll respect my son. And when Jesus came, he came in perfection. Every word that came out of his mouth was not him speaking. He said, everything I do, I see my Father, and I do what my Father says. The most important thing you have to recognize is that when Jesus came, he didn't come as Jesus, but he came as Jesus, the revelation of God's love. He came to reveal God to us. We could not understand God until it was spoken in human language. In human language, God's thoughts made audible through Jesus Christ, the Christ, the anointed one. And his purpose, not only to die for us upon the cross, because without the cross, there's just a lot of head knowledge. But take it to us without grace. But as God, as Jesus being revealed the Father God to us, it should change us and transform us. He speaks the language that only those who are prompted by the Holy Spirit, that you need the Spirit of God. Remember, I brought it up last week. I put down the word Jesus, I put down the word God. I said, well, where is the Holy Spirit in all of this? In you. Where is the Holy Spirit? Where is he, guys? He's in you. And it's the Holy Spirit, through the power of God, because the Holy Spirit is in the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit is being planted in you. And the Holy Spirit is prompting your heart for more. Just to create a hunger and a thirst after righteousness. And as you hunger and thirst after righteousness, you want to know more about him. It's a love story. And one of the things that I brought about this love story was this. When I read the Old Testament, I remember taking a course on the Old Testament. I remember killed this nation, destroyed this nation, wiped every donkey, calf, and everything in that village. Just wipe it out clean. I said, where is the love? I thought this was a love story. Wishy-washy, mushy-moony-moony love story. And here I see a nation coming into the promised land and destroy those giants, get rid of them. And I'm like, where is the love? You ever asked that question? Then I started thinking a little further. Wait a minute, more than a love story. It's a battleground. We are living in a battleground. Last week I talked about in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And that was it. God didn't explain who he was. He just said, I created the heavens and the earth. Without explanation, like, now I'm going to explain to you who I am. He did. Why? Because we're a finite human being. Finite is, if I could measure it to a dot, I don't know, maybe I can take a dot, should have put a dot there. Measure a dot, and then go on for a trillion, trillion, trillion times trillion light years, forever and ever and ever. And ever, in that infinity. And this little dot here is supposed to understand at all. Never going to happen. But yet, God's not out here to explain, but he will reveal certain parts of himself to you, that he is your creator. And that in him, he created something that was very unique. You are his image. He created a person in his image. Communicate that. But something happened. Eldeborough tapped on. Something happened before Adam and Eve. That maybe explains why we got so much bloodshed on this earth. And this is what part two is all about. I'm going to drag this thing so you understand. I'm going to drag it out so you're going to have to stay tuned to part three, part four, part five. Because I want you to understand this one little foundational truth. That way you can build on to it. Anybody seen the new World Trade Center? Remember, I'm New Yorker, right? Now they got one World Trade Center. In the beginning, years and years went by. They said, we're going to rebuild it. We're going to rebuild it. We're going to rebuild it. They were building it. And you didn't see it. Why? They were working on the foundation. They were working on the foundation. The paperwork, the blueprint was all there. They figured out what the right building was going to be. But now it's the foundation. Without that foundation, that World Trade Center would just pop right over, imploded, or fallen down. The foundation is the key. Jesus is our foundation. Without this foundation, if I can't bring Christ as your foundational truth, everything I'm going to build upon is going to sit right back down under the ground. It's going to implode on you. It's going to tilt. It's going to fall. And you're going to wonder why is this thing not sinking in. The foundation is Jesus the Christ. Once we have that foundation of truth, who is Jesus? Is he just a man? A lot of people say just a man. He's a good prophet. He had a lot to say. He's a good teacher. That's how you see him? Then you put him next to the other good teachers, the other good philosophers. And he died a tragic death. Yes, he was a good man. I know some of you know more, but some of you don't. You know there's something more about Jesus Christ. But every week you're going to have a little more revelation of it. This is what we want to go through. So, the question was last week was, how did a loving, infinite God end up with a planet full of sinners? If God is so perfect, why are we a ragtag team? You know? I think we're better. Before, I think people, by the time they were 40 years old, talking about it, before we had all these cures, you were ready to die. 40, you were old. And then I said, well, 60 became the new 40. And now, Social Security is in trouble because people are going beyond the Social Security year. They thought you'd be gone. They were only paying you for 2 years. You're going to disappear. And we're living longer. We're living longer. Anyway, let's go further. And this is back to Isaiah. Let me see if I wrote it down.
Well, this was the question. I already didn't even know I had to point it out. How did a loving, infinite God end up with a planet full of sinners? Well, let's find out.
Come back to what Elder Burroughs read, and I'm going to read it again. I have to read it because something happened in heaven and came down to earth. He said, how you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who have weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest side of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the cloud. I will be like the Most High. Anybody know who Lucifer is? Anybody this Sunday school class? Okay.
The light bearer.
The light bearer. A little quotation, the light bearer. He was one of the cherubs, one of the angels that God created. When God created everything, everything was perfect. The one principle about the kingdom of God, in order for us to exist, and this is how we have to exist, is that we must give in order for us to receive. Let me try again. We must give. I'm testing this thing. In order for us to receive. The principle of God is this, is that our life-giving force is not to keep it to ourselves, but it's to pour out upon others. The kingdom of God is always a kingdom of giving, and as you give life, life will come back to you. If you look at the statement of this shirt, who was an angel of God, something changed it. He looked inside himself. I know every time I look inside myself, I'm in trouble. When I'm preparing a sermon, I ask this question, who are you seeing? If I don't see Jesus, I'm in trouble. If I see me, I'm in trouble. I have to see Jesus in every word I say. I have to be Jesus at the focus. Lucifer was assured. He was near the throne of God. He knew the presence of God. He knew the Son. something changed inside himself. He looked inside himself. I'm going to repeat it.
He looked at
how you are the fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning, how you are cut down to the ground, how you weaken the nation. For you have said in your heart, remember, this is his heart talking. And welcome down the heart, guys. As your heart comes out, whatever is inside of you. He said, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also, there's a lot of eyes, you notice that. I will sit on the mount of the congregation, on the farthest side of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. This is the one that interests me the most. He said, I will be like the Most High. I will be like the Most High. Who's the Most High? God, Father God. He's saying, I'm going to be like God. I'm going to take over. Can a created being become God? I have a feeling after what? Probably didn't even realize he was created. He may have been around the throne of God too long. Have you ever gone to school and thought you learned it all? I think when I graduated from elementary school, I was so excited and then came to high school. And then graduated from high school, I got so excited and then come to college. And it's always something level. And then you end up working and you find out there's always something new to learn. Always something new to learn. There's never a dull moment. There must have been a stage where Lucifer probably said, you know what? I know just as much as you, God. I don't know how long this sure was near the throne of God. You know, we have time, you know. We live, what, 80, 90 years old? They don't give a timetable, do they? Because as far as I'm concerned, there is no time. There is no sun setting, but God's glory is all around. But this one unusual thing is, let's take a trillion years from by. Let me give you an example. Let's say I went to school for a trillion years. Simple example. And who's my teacher? Right next to me, Father God. Won't you think maybe I know just as much as God? I'm just thinking, what brought him to this place? You know, I can't imagine. I don't know. But one of the things was, is that he looked into himself. He was no longer looking to the Father God. And one principle in the Bible is that what you behold, you become. Interesting principle. Look at something long enough. Stare at it long enough. Meditate on it long enough. You become. You look at Christ, you become like Christ. You look at yourself, you're full of yourself. And I have a feeling that's what happened here. But let's go a little further, because Revelation seems to be talking a little bit more. First, the word was the fall of Lucifer. Now, all of a sudden, I see the word Satan thrown out of heaven. First, Lucifer was literally meaning day star. I didn't look up Satan. Anybody look up Satan? Deceiver, accuser, the brethren? Which one? Adversary? Adversary. So, from light bearer, a day star, he became an adversary. And let's read what it has to say here. And war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought with the dragon, and the dragon and angels fought, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceived the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and an angel was cast out with him. They will cast out where, guys?
The bottom over there.
They will cast out to the earth. Lucky us. Because you know what? Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden in the physical earth was being created. Who's cast down? Our next door neighbor, you know, You ever worry and complain about your next door neighbor? Well, guess who's coming to dinner? There was war in heaven. First it started with the sword, that he will ascend on high. This was one being. All of a sudden there's war. War. Is there war with just one being? I don't think so. He deceived the whole world, and he was cast down to earth, and boom, his angels were cast out with him. So it must have took a long time for him to influence a lot of angels that agreed with him. I don't know you, but heaven was a family. And the family was divided. I don't know if you ever have family feuds where you say, I'm not going to talk to you anymore. This is it. I had it with you. This family was divided. Satan and his angels, they became his angels. Who was the creator? The boss of God. He created every living being. And now here, they're cast down to heaven. Thank you. This is my backup man. But let's go a little further here. This is found in Ezekiel. It says, you were in the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering. The sardis, topaz, and diamond, beryl, onyx, and jasper, sapphire, turquoise, emerald, and gold. The workmanship of your trebles and pipes was prepared for you on the day you were created. You were the anointed shirt who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fire of stones. Who is he talking about? Lucifer, the light, who became the adversary. He was beautiful. He was a majestic being. And God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void. And in 6 days, he created everything that you see here. And he created man. And he created woman. And he planted them in the garden. And in the midst of the garden, there was a tree of knowledge of good and evil. I used to have this old saying. Couldn't you put the tree on the other side of the planet? You know, maybe like a trek. No, it was right in the midst of the garden. Why? Challenge is happening right now. You just lost your family members in heaven. They were cast down to earth. God created us. And we were made a little lower than the angels. I'm building a foundation for guys. I want you to understand. Something happened in heaven that came down here to earth. You want to know why we were in this mess, right? We need to know what happened. Here comes the question. What happened at the Garden of Eden? I'm sure you all have the Sunday school classes. I'm not done right now. Question. How did they easily fall? How did they so easily fall? Question. Come next week to find out. And the next thing, invite someone to the series. I don't want to take this and just throw it all at one time. There you didn't I? But look, I do it again. It doesn't happen. Something's going on. There's nothing. It's Holy Spirit's power that's coming out of me. But the whole idea, I'm slowly building. I started last week with Christ. That he came to do what? Anybody remember? Reveal the Father's love. He was filled with the revelation of God's love. Why did he have to come to reveal the Father's love to people who were made in the image of God? What happened at the Garden of Eden? How did they so easily fall? Why are we in this mess? I always told you I'm going to end my sermons with more questions. But next week you come and get the answers. And guess what? I'm going to end with more questions. But we're going to build the foundation. See, once we build the foundation, then we're going to start to grow. Once we know where our roots are from, why all this happened, then we'll understand our destiny. You have to know our origin. We have to know why these things happen. So that way we know that going to church is not just making God happy and just paying some attribute, something to make, you know, a token for God. No, there's something more. We have a purpose for being here. What Jesus did on the cross, God giving his son to us, his blood being shed for us. You are something special. You are loved. You are special. But something happened at that door. Anybody want to know what happened on next week? So, what do I say now? Dear Heavenly Father, all I'm doing right now is just planting seeds. All I'm doing right now is trying to understand the very beginning, Father. What happened to heaven? How we're taken down to earth? And how it affected our original parents, dear Lord. And how we ended up here right now, this church, at this moment in time. Lord, we know that more than we can imagine. We think we were just born out of the blue. No, you created us for purpose. You knew our name before the foundations of the world. You knew our heart. You knew we would be here listening to these words. I am praying right now that we have a little extra hunger for you. Understanding of the roots, understanding the beginning. That way we can understand our destination, what we will become, what we will be. And that the people that are surrounding us right now are the children that you died for. So Heavenly Father, we ask that you place in our heart a coal of fire that we can. I ask you, Father, place in our being a hunger that only you can feed, a thirst that only you can quench. We love you, Father. We want to understand you, and we want to understand your Son, and we want to understand the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. So I ask you, dear Lord, that we plant these seeds into everyone's heart here, everywhere else, Lord, that we every day will seek after you, pray, Lord, give me more life. We were not an accident. We have a purpose. Bless this congregation and all those around us and all those that are out there in the world. Lord, bless them. We ask you to be told. Thank you.
that's the word.